Hello everyone and welcome to this new tutorial. Today I want to share with you how I created this rain animation video that I posted about a week ago. So if you haven't seen the video yet, just click on the link below, check the video out, and I'll see you back here in a second. Alright, so this is my original scene, and for those of you that have been following my channel for a long time now, this type of terrain will seem kind of familiar, and the reason for that is basically because I use the same technique that I show you guys in the tutorial series on how to make a forest scene. So I'm not gonna explain how to go about creating this terrain, because if you wanna get in-depth information on how to get this kind of result, you can go to that tutorial series. I'm going to leave the link over here for those of you that haven't seen that. And I'll concentrate this time on how to create the particle system and the water ripple. So let's begin. Okay, so let's begin by checking our particle simulation. Now, this is a fairly simple particle simulation. There are two key elements here that you have to take into account. The first one, it's the particle system itself. And the second one is a wind modifier that I added just to add some variation to the movement of the particle system. Now, let's check the properties for the particle system itself. Now, first things first, this particle generator is slightly bigger than the terrain that I have. So, for an instance, my terrain is 10 meters by 10 meters. And my particle generator is 12 meters by 12 meters. And the reason for that is that I wanted to make sure that the particles were going to cover the totality of the terrain. Now let's go to the properties, the particle properties, and let's see what we did here. The first thing that I changed was that I wanted to have at least 40 particles for each frame. So this is usually set by second, so I changed that to make sure that we have at least 40 particles each frame, and that's going to give us a bunch of particles at the same time. Now, the other thing that I made sure it was that I set the particle limit to 10,000 because I knew we were generating quite a lot of particles at the same time. I just wanted to make sure that we were going to have enough particles to cover the whole animation. Now, if you saw the video is about 20 seconds long, but this animation is only 5 seconds long. And the reason for that was that I basically made a cycle. I repeated the same animation like 3 or 4 times. And I'll show you how to do that later, but that's fine. So let's continue here. Now, if you see here in my animation, when I move the time slider, I have particles from the very first frame. And the way I did that was simply that I changed the starting frame of my particle simulation. It is normally set at frame 0, but I just click here on fixed and I changed the start frame to 0, from 0 to negative 40. Let's go check the second tab. In here I essentially didn't modify anything, so it's the default values here. And in motion I just changed the velocity in the X and the Y axis, so we had some sort of a direction of our particles, but it's not as important because we are still going to add some wind. So I just added a little bit of velocity in the X and Y axis, and I added a little bit of explosion and vibration so the particles were a little bit erratic when they were falling. The last thing that I modified here was the gravity. So I added some gravity in the Y axis. I added a value of -8, and that's how they fall. Now the other element, it's fairly simple. It's a dynamic object called wind, effects wind, and I simply added the wind by coming here to items, dynamic object wind, and I selected a direction wind, and I made sure that the radius was 10 meters, so it covered the totality of the terrain, and the power was 100%. So as you can see, it's a fairly simple simulation. Now about the shading, I added some hypervoxels to this particle. So just go to the hypervoxel tab that you can find under the volumetric tab. So I added some hypervoxels here. My particle system is called Rainfall, so we just selected the Rainfall and activated the hypervoxels for it. And in here I didn't do anything. As I told you before, I'm a little bit lazy, so I use one of the presets. And the preset is here, the glass preset. So since particles are going to fall so fast, the glass preset is going to look like water. So that's how I did it. Now let's go and check on how I created the water ripples in the water. Let's open our surface editor. In here, you'll see that I basically modified the water preset that comes with Lightwave, which is this water preset that you're going to find under the Nature tab. And I changed the color of it just the same way I did on the forest tutorial. And after that, I came here to the transparency channel and added some transparency using a gradient. Now, what I wanted to achieve here was that I wanted the water to be a slightly transparent on the top and get a little bit murky towards the bottom. So to do that, I added a gradient. I made sure that the input parameter was surface thickness. It starts at 0 meters, which is the surface itself, and it ends at 1 meter. So the top of the water is going to be have a value of 70%, and the bottom is going to have a value of 0%. So that was basically it. The trick to get the ripples, it's modifying the bump tab. Now the bump tab for the water preset only comes with a crumple procedural texture, which is the one that generates a little bit of that wave effect on the surface. So after that, I added another procedural texture called ripples that you find here on the procedural textures list. And what I did here was that I preserved basically the same default values, but I changed the layer opacity to 50%, so we get those ripples added to the crumple we already have. And of course I use the blending mode as additive. And last but not least, the trick to get the ripples is on another procedural texture called crust. Is a procedural texture that is going to allow us to get that little ripple effect. Now what I did here was that I modified the scale of this procedural texture, because as you can see over here in the preview, the ripples are huge. So I just changed this value from 1 meter to 0.2 meters, so the scale makes a little bit more sense. And after that, I changed the position of it and animated it on an envelope. Now, the trick is that you have to understand that procedural textures work in 3D space, which means that you can move them in the Z axis, the Y axis, and the X axis, and they're going to act as if they were in 3D space. So what I did here was that I came here to the Y axis, I pressed the E of envelope, and I changed the Y position over time. So at frame 0, nothing's going on, the value is 0, and in frame 120, it moves down 2 meters. So that's how I did that, so the procedural texture moves over time 2 meters down. And that's how you get that sort of ripple animation on the water. Now, as I told you before, this animation, it's only 5 seconds, but the video itself, it's 20 seconds. So we are going to take a look on how I created the edit or the comp for this video in After Effects. So I'm going to close this one down. I'm going to open my scene in After Effects, and I'll see you there. So we are now in After Effects, and we're going to take a quick look to what I did to complete this animation. So the first step was to color correct this, so I added some levels and curves adjustment to get some more contrast out of the original render. After that, I added an adjustment layer where I use a CC rainfall effect that is going to keep the illusion that there are more particles than the ones that I originally rendered from Lightwave. After that, I pre-comp these layers into one single layer called Rocks. After that, I cloned this layer Rocks and renamed it Bloom. And what I did to this one was to add some contrast. I desaturated this, and after that I added some blurriness. I also set the transparency to 20%, and finally I screened this copy on top of the original one to get that sort of glow effect that sort of gives the sense of an ambience in the scene. After that, I actually pre-comped these two layers into one single layer called background. This layer, it's actually the one where I extended the animation. So as you can see over here, there are three copies of the very same sequence. Now, when one of the sequences is finishing, the other one it's starting. Now, if you take a closer look, there's a big jump or a big gap between animations, and that's because there's not a perfect loop. So in order to solve this little jump, I used a little trick. I added a new adjustment layer where I applied a couple of effects. So the first effect that I applied was a CC lens effect. So if I turn this one off, you'll see what the CC lens effect does. It gives the impression that it was actually shot on camera. After that, I added some noise, and noise, it's simply to add some grain and noise to the render so it doesn't look as perfect. And finally, I added some animated exposure. So if you take a look at the keyframes over here, the animation of the exposure happens right when the transition is happening. So if you are distracted by the lightning, there's transition between sequences is happening. So that's the way I hide the transition. After that, I pre-comped all these layers once again, and I called this one Shake. The reason for this to be called Shake, it's because I scaled this up and use a Wiggle-Rama effect to give the feeling that there was a sort of a handheld camera, that it was a handheld camera filming. And of course I extended this so you first listen to the rain and the lightning, and then the whole thing shows up and then it fades out. And the last thing you should know is that I added a vignette on top, and this also keeps the illusion that it was shot on camera and that it has a little bit more depth. So this is how it was done. Well, I hope this was useful to all of you. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, where you will be able to find some other useful tutorials. If you have any questions regarding this topic, don't hesitate to ask me, and I hope to see you next time.